happened. I'm comparing the two to you. It's not going to have the camera. Wasn't that long ago?
Binary fusion.
It's not that early in the morning, guys. What's going on? I know you're smart enough. I've seen your exam grade. Okay?
So, I don't know if it'll help. But think about it. When someone's pregnant, do they eat a lot?
Mm-hmm.
Why do they eat a lot? Right. But let's break it down to the chemistry of what they're doing. They're eating for two because they have to produce enough energy to basically build a whole other organism. Right? So we've got to do subdivision. Got it? Alright. Okay, so the first catabolic reaction we walked you through is glycolysis. What's the first, in the first chemical reaction of glycolysis? Now, by the way, is glycolysis a catabolic or an anabolic reaction? Catabolic. What is the substrate of the first reaction of glycolysis? Glucose. How many of you rewrote your notes? Okay, good. The rest of you need to do that. How many carbons does glucose have?
Six.
Now, I'm jumping ahead. After you go through about nine different reactions, okay,
but I'm not going through all of them. You're required for the first and the last. What's the final end product of glycolysis? You start out with glucose with six carbons. What do you end up with? Pyruvate, which is three carbons. How many pyruvates with three carbons?
Two. So you've, of course, conserved on your carbon. You haven't lost any.
Right? So you see how that's lysis. You're breaking it down. Right? What else do you produce besides pyruvate?
NADH. How many?
Two.
What else? How many?
Two.
So a net of two ATP. Right?
So what made it a catabolic reaction is you make ATP and you're breaking down a molecule, right? So it satisfies both of the categories.
Alright, so the first chemical reaction of glycolysis, the substrate is glucose. What's the enzyme?
Hexokinase.
How many of you can do this without your notes? Okay. Those of you who can't keep in mind when your exam comes, you're going to have to be able to do it without your notes. Okay. So, I don't want you guys waiting until the last minute. Okay? So, if you learn this
Bless you.
Sooner, it might stick with you by the time you exam. So this stuff doesn't work for cram, just for the money. Okay? And what would be the product? Glucose 6-phosphate. I'm writing it like that. What's another substrate for the reaction? ATP. And what's another product?
ADP.
Alright. What binds, which of these molecules bind to the active site of hexokinase? The substrate. So which ones are the substrates?
Glucose and ATP.
Okay, good. Yeah. Glucose and ATP. Good? Alright. Now, let's skip several steps. So you see these dash arrows? That's always meaning you're skipping a whole bunch of steps. For the last chemical reaction, so I'm skipping boatloads of steps. So just keep that in mind. That's a lot of steps. That's what I'm going to go to the next one. We already know for the last reaction, you make two pyruvate, which has three carbons. What's the substrate for this reaction?
That's the phosphoenolphosphate.
Phosphoenyl pyruvate.
Oh, the pyruvate.
Yeah, phosphoenyl pyruvate. This is abbreviated as PEP. I know this was a little bit more of a mouthful. Okay. What's the enzyme?
the pyruvate kinase.
So what do kinase enzymes do? Alright, what's another substrate here?
The ADP.
And product?
ATP.
Now, we know it's a kinase, so we know a phosphate is transferred. So the phosphate is transferred from what? It's transferred from somewhere to somewhere else, right? So what's the source of the phosphate? The PEP, right? The PEP is the source of the ATP. So phosphate is transferred from PEP to what? Where are you moving the phosphate to? You're taking this phosphate, and where are you putting it? I heard it, but I can't hear it.
ADP?
Huh?
She's saying ADP.
ADP, exactly. If you move a phosphate from PEP to ADP, right, then you converted ADP to ATP, right? And you've removed that phosphate off of phosphate and pyruvate, so now it's going to convert it to pyruvate. So I don't know what I hope I'm getting you guys to do right now is not just memorize reactions, but to be able to extract information from that reaction. Right?
Mm-hmm.
And because your exam is going to basically put everything from a chemical reaction into word format, right? So it's not necessarily about being able to draw the reaction, right? To just rote memorize. You have to be able to extract information out of it. You guys good? Okay. So this is, you made ATP here, right? What is the mechanism for making ATP in this reaction? There's a particular term for it, and that's where I ended last time. You might not have gotten it because it was, you might have been like hurrying at the end there. Okay. So can somebody give me a definition of substrate level phosphorylation?
The phosphate is directly transferred from the substrate molecule to ADP by an enzyme to generate ATP.
Yeah, did you read that or did you read it?
I read it.
Okay, so I want you to be able to do that without reading it, right? And then to be able to come up with your own definition, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, do you understand why this process is called substrate level phosphorylation? What's the substrate in that reaction?
The phosphoenol, the PEP with the ADP.
The phosphoenol pyruvate, right? So the phosphate is coming from your substrate. Got it? Always break everything down. Break down the words. Almost everything in biology makes sense. And you take everything logically. Good? So this is pretty much what we did last class for you. So everybody's comfortable with this?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So this process is called glycolysis. Alright. Now, can I erase this idea? Alright. Now what we're going to, I'm starting with that because that was the reasonable way to start. But what we're going to start out with is cellular respiration. And many of you who had bio 1 have had your syllabus. Cellular respiration is divided into two different categories of cellular respiration. There's aerobic cellular respiration, and there's anaerobic cellular respiration. Alright, aerobic. What does that mean to you when you hear the word aerobic?
Oxygen.
So molecular oxygen, yeah. So during aerobic cellular respiration, molecular oxygen gas. What is anaerobic?
tell you. Without oxygen.
Okay. So,
there is no O2 gas. Now, for those of you who took bio 1, we didn't even talk to you about anaerobic cellular respiration. We just didn't even really follow it. But we did talk about aerobic cellular respiration. Yourself, do they undergo aerobic cellular respiration or anaerobic cellular respiration?
Aerobic.
We know we got no oxygen, right? Now, prokaryotes, because remember prokaryotes, you guys have already looked at oxygen repository, right? You guys already looked at the tubes during your lab practical and the week before, and were able to tell if an organism has facultative oxygen requirement or if not, we get aerobic oxygen requirement, right? And the facultative can grow with or without oxygen, right? So right here, you know prokaryotes can do some kind of chemistry, metabolism, that does not require oxygen. So they can basically go through an aerobic process. There's another process that's also called fermentation, that they can go through, which is anaerobic. We'll get to that later. Guys, good? All right. Now, anaerobic respiration and aerobic respiration are very similar. There's only one little difference that comes in at the end of the process. So what I'm going to do is go through aerobic cellular respiration first, and then I'll explain the difference with anaerobic. All right, so aerobic cellular respiration, we break down into four different processes that happen sequentially, the one after the other in a particular order. So the first step is glycolysis. We can just go through. The second step, depending on what book you use, there's a variety of different terms that you collect. I will use pyruvate oxidation because that gives you the most information. So it's the most informative term. You might see on my slide, because I'm not going to pull in my slides, I'm putting them up, you might see it written as preparatory step. Or transition. Third step is the citric acid cycle. And that has three different names for it. So, and I use them interchangeably. So, citric acid cycle, Krebs cycle, which is named after the guy who figured out these chemical reactions, and TCA cycle. And TCA cycle stands for tricarboxylate. And I will never come into the tricarboxylate acid cycle because that's too much. I will probably at most, I don't know, I use all of them, and I use all of them. And the fourth, I use slightly different terminology sometimes than books do. I say the electron transport chain and ATP synthase. Most textbooks together will basically say electron transport chain and often abbreviated ETC. And a lot of books will use the term hemiosmosis. And I'll explain that in a few minutes for ATP synthase. So just be somewhat aware of all the different terminology. Unfortunately, that is one of the problems that we all right, so I want you to know that they actually go in this particular order. So this would be considered a biochemical pathway. So cellular respiration is a biochemical pathway that's made up of other biochemical pathways. In any biochemical pathway, do I cover biochemical pathways with you guys? Did I do the thing, I can't remember between my classes, where substrate A goes to product B, and product B is then as a substrate for. Mm-hmm. Right? Okay. So
biochemical pathways, which you want to remember, is the product of glycolysis is the substrate for pyruvate oxidation. The product of pyruvate oxidation is the substrate for the acidic acid. The product of the acidic acid cycle is the substrate for the electrolyte. So I don't know if you figured this out, but one of the nice things, if you try to focus on just memorizing everything and not understanding everything, you're going to get screwed. If you can memorize a few pieces of a puzzle, and you know the basic concepts of the themes, you can use another theme. Okay? So that's one of the things you're going to remember to read now.
The product of glycolysis is a substrate for pyruvate oxidation. The product of pyruvate oxidation is a substrate for oxidation. So let's say you can say, oh, I can write off the fat, rattle off the product of this, but I can't tell you what the substrate of this is. Then all you do is step through by the
good?
Now, I've been mostly talking about prokaryotes, but cellular respiration obviously is not solely the domain of prokaryotes, because we know we do cellular respiration. Fungi do cellular respiration. So like molds, they use air, they do cellular respiration. Protists do cellular respiration. So it is the cellular respiration occurs across the whole phylogenetic tree in all the different ways. Right? Now, some of the details of it, though, mm-hmm. So this I think is always useful to do. Where these processes happen in eukaryotes versus in prokaryotes. Both eukaryotes and prokaryotes, glycolysis happens in the cytoplasm. So it happens in the cytoplasm for both. In the case of eukaryotes, the pyruvate that is made at the end of glycolysis has to get moved. So it gets moved from the cytoplasm into the mitochondria. In Bio 1, we went over more detail of exactly where in the mitochondria. In this class, we are not going to do that. So most of you have learned something about the mitochondria as the energy generating organ of eukaryotic cells, right? So the mitochondria is not only just an energy generating cell in the organelle, it is the site of cellular respiration in eukaryotes. So remember, the mitochondria in eukaryotes is the site of cellular oxidation. Where in a prokaryote do you think pyruvate oxidation would happen? Does a prokaryote have an organelle? Mm-hmm. So where would it happen? Cytoplasm. Yeah, the other place. It's either the cytoplasm or the membrane. It ain't going to happen to the membrane. All of these reactions, by the way, that all the glycolysis, all of those molecules are hydrophilic. None of them are hydrophobic. So they're not going to happen to the membrane. The only choice is cytoplasm. In the case of eukaryotes, the citric acid cycle occurs in the mitochondria. So the pyruvate from glycolysis is moved into mitochondria for pyruvate oxidation. The product of pyruvate oxidation is still sitting in the mitochondria, and so then you can go on to the next step. Where does the current prokaryote? Cytoplasm. The electron transport chain, by the way, occurs in exists in a membrane. So I'll go into more of this later. So this also occurs in the mitochondria of eukaryotes.
And this would be, actually let me write, I'm going to put mitochondrial membrane. Sorry, I'm blocking the name. So across, this would be across the mitochondrial membrane. There are multiple membranes in the whole liquid. What membrane, how many membranes do we have up here for this? This one. This membrane is up here. Yeah, this one is up. So the electron transport chain occurs across the cell membrane. I want you to remember, even though I focus on prokaryotes, these processes happen in basically in all of the members' blood. Not every organism is going to do this, but it happens across the members' blood. Good? Should I erase all this? And the next reaction I am going to do on the board, I haven't gotten the slides yet, and I still just do it because I feel like it works way better when I use the board. Okay? If you have any questions, just interrupt me as we go through. Okay. The next step is pyruvate oxidation. In pyruvate oxidation, the substrate is pyruvate, right? The product of glycolysis. And your substrate is pyruvate. You guys already told me your substrate is pyruvate. Pyruvate is being oxidized. Okay. So that's why I like using the term pyruvate oxidation. Because you know pyruvate is getting oxidized. So pyruvate is getting oxidized. Is it losing an electron or gaining an electron? Losing. Right? Leo, loss of electron oxidized. Pyruvate is oxidized, so you're losing an electron. When we lose an electron, in what form do we usually lose it? As a hydrogen. So, oxidation and reduction reactions go hand in hand. So, when pyruvate is getting oxidized, something else is getting reduced. Right? Now, at the same, so pyruvate is oxidized, something else is reduced. And I covered an electron carrier last time. That is really good at accepting and donating electrons. Anybody remember what it is? NAD plus. Okay. So, pyruvate is going to hand its electron from the hydrogen to NAD plus. So NAD plus will be reduced to
NADH.
And just by remembering the name. Pyruvate oxidation. You know, pyruvate is oxidized, and thereby NAD is reduced. Good?
Mm-hmm.
Alright. Now, at this, when pyruvate loses an electron, it then becomes a compound called acetyl-CoA. CoA is a... Oh, you were stretching. Oh, okay. CoA, just so you know, is an abbreviation for coenzyme A. And coenzyme A is a vitamin. And I might have a picture of it on the slide, but I'm not holding it responsible. Okay. Tell me again how many carbons pyruvate has?
Three.
Right, and I'm going to just tell you that an acetyl group has two carbons. So whenever you see the word acetyl, you know that it's two carbons. Now, I'm going to just tell you this vitamin CoA is input, right? So CoA is input, pyruvate is input, CoA is a constant pyruvate, but then you're going from this, the acetyl-CoA is not attached to a three-carbon molecule, it's attached to a two-carbon molecule. So, we lost a carbon somewhere, right? Where do you get the carbon? And it wasn't there.
then you exhale. Like an option, cut it up. So whenever we're breaking down an organic molecule, we'll ultimately break it down to carbon dioxide. Good? And so through the process of respiration, you're slowly pulling carbons off of glucose. Does this make sense? So you took from a 6-carbon to a 3-carbon. Now we're taking a 3-carbon compound to a 2-carbon. When you pull that 1 carbon off, it gets released to CO2. Good? So that is all that happens in a pyruvate oxidation. This one chemical reaction. And I am not telling you the name of the enzyme. It does this reaction. I'm going to leave out. Good? Because ultimately, that's not that important. Ultimately, what's important for this is the input to the output. So I want you to know input is pyruvate. I want you to know input is NAD. I want you to know the output is acetyl-CoA because it's just important for the next step. But you know an output is NADH. That would be important as well. And I want you to remember to CO2. Your lysine, all that, that organic carbon. Are you guys good? Now, how many pyruvates did you end up with at the end of glycolysis? How many pyruvates? Two. Do both pyruvates go through pyruvate oxidation? Yeah, both of them do. Do they both go through pyruvate oxidation? You double a cookie recipe. You just double the flour, or you double the milk, and you have double the sugar, and you double the butter? Double everything. So, both of those pyruvates are going to go through pyruvate oxidation. So you'll double that. You'll double that. Double that. Double that. Double that. Double that. Guys, good? So I want you to remember that. You get two pyruvates. Both pyruvates go through oxidation. Is any ATP generated here? But I want you to keep in mind this is NADH. You guys good so far? Everybody's got this written down? Now, I'm going to have to read this first part of this. This acetyl-CoA then goes to feed the citric acid cycle. So remember we just said that the product is the substrate for the next. So I like to think of it as feeding. One thing's feeding the next thing, it's feeding the next thing. Like the food chain. So the acetyl-CoA enters the citric acid cycle. And it is a chemical reaction that is cyclic, where the product ends up joining with the substrate in the cycle continues. Like that's why it's gone in circular. There's not a defined beginning and a defined end. I am not having you memorize the chemical reaction of the citric acid. It's too much. I don't even know too much. But I want you to know that the 2-acetyl-CoA enter the citric acid cycle, join with other carbon compounds, and I'll go over a 6-carbon compound, and then you'll end up with an 8-carbon compound. You can see a whole bunch of chemical reactions also, but I'm not going to make you responsible. Alright, you go through all these chemical reactions, the output, okay, and I'm going to write now, I'm going to erase all of this here, and I'm going to start out with 1-acetyl-CoA molecule. So 1-acetyl-CoA molecule that feeds the citric acid cycle ends up outputting 3-NADH. So 3-NAD plus gets reduced to 3-NADH. And I'm just, this is the sum. Okay, I'm not telling you exactly what it is. 1-FAD molecule gets reduced to FADH. One NAD molecule So you're not making a lot of ATP here. We didn't make any during pyruvate oxidation. We made it two during glycolysis. Now, this method of generating ATP in the citric acid cycle, it is by substrate level phosphorylation. Even though I'm not intended for substrate, and if you look at the pictures in the book, it's going to look a little bit more complicated. And it is a little bit more complicated, but for the purpose of this class, we're just going to go with this. Okay? You guys good so far? Now, how many acetyl-CoAs did you generate from pyruvate oxidation? Two. Okay, so a lot of the questions are going to be from one glucose molecule, right? How many pyruvates do you get? From one glucose molecule, how many acetyl-CoAs do you get? So you guys were able to say two. Do both of them go into the citric acid cycle? Both will go into the citric acid cycle. So if you have one giving you three NADH, one NADH two, and one NADH two, if you input two, how many would you have changed in number two?
Six.
Six. Right? Just like the two, by the way. And you can take that
two.
Two.
Yeah, it's the malt.
Oh, you understand the question?
Mm-hmm.
Oh. You got, like, you're going to have two hydrogens. You got the hydrogen to double up to four.
Oh, no.
It's just when FAD gets reduced, so NAD plus, when it gets reduced, it goes to NADH. FAD, when it gets reduced, it's to FAD. There is no such thing as FAD. It just doesn't exist. Good? Of our inputs and our outputs before we get to the next stage. The next stage is also one of the harder stages to follow, so I'm probably going to go back to the slides for a minute just to kind of give you a break so that you can see something that you're going to see. But let's do the summary. And the summary that I really care about has to do with the amount of NADH or FADH2 and the amount of ATP that you're getting. Okay. But in general, you're going to want to be able to do inputs and outputs. So, for glycolysis, how many NADH do you need?
Two.
How many ATP do you need? What else did you make? No ADP. No ATP, no ADP got involved at all. Right? citric acid cycle from one glucose molecule. How many NADH? From one glucose? Six. How many NADH? How many ATP? Now, I did not tell you this yet. We also use CO2. So for every one acetyl-CoA, you're taking this two-carbon acetyl-CoA, and you're breaking it into the two carbons. So you're doing your final splits, right, of the carbon. So from one acetyl-CoA, you release two CO2, right? Does that make sense? From two acetyl-CoA, you end up with four CO2. So we're having conservation of carbon, right? So here you have two carbon, two one carbon compounds, here you have two carbon, right? Here we have two carbon compounds with a total of four carbons, and you're going to use four carbon compounds. Okay, I don't have any. Make sense? So we've taken our six carbon glucose, right? And broken it down into six CO2. So but we have to go through several steps to keep breaking those bonds to bring it all the way down. Does all of this make sense? Yeah? Okay. I'm gonna guess maybe a little popping when it needs to happen. The ATP that's made here is made by substrate level phosphorylation. The ATP made here is made by substrate level phosphorylation. The reason I mention that is because when we go to the electron transport chain in ATP synthase, we're going to talk about a different process, which is called oxidative phosphorylation. And that's the terminology I forgot to mention earlier. So, electron transport chain. So basically what happens is the electron transport chain and ATP synthase collectively, this process is called oxidative phosphorylation. In oxidative phosphorylation, and I'm probably not going to write all this down. Oxidative phosphorylation is a mechanism of generating ATP. So it's a mechanism of generating ATP that is distinct from substrate level phosphorylation. In oxidative phosphorylation, you have to have a membrane. So remember I told you that electron transport chain and ATP synthase happen across either a mitochondrial membrane or a cytoplasmic membrane? So a membrane is required for oxidative phosphorylation. The phosphate that is added to ADP during oxidative phosphorylation is inorganic phosphate, so P sub I. It is not attached to any carbon, so that phosphate does not come from the substrate. You also need an enzyme called ATP synthase that also exists in the membrane. So they're very different, right? Substrate level phosphorylation is a membrane involved at all. No, I never mentioned a membrane. Was a substrate involved? Was a phosphate attached to carbon? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Whereas in oxidative phosphorylation, it's not. You guys good so far? Now, oxidative phosphorylation generates way more ATP than substrate level phosphorylation.
So far the amount of ATP 4 is actually not very much. It's actually quite a bit small. You guys good? And with oxidative phosphorylation, we'll go into something like 10 different ATP. Okay. I told you energy stored in ATP molecules, right? So whenever we say stored energy, we call it potential energy. It's good that I bring that up because I will use the term potential energy, stored potential energy later. Usually when you took like a physics class or something, physical science class, they usually always taught you stored potential energy by the skateboarder on the top of the hill, right? That has the stored energy. And as you go down the hill, you release that energy and you basically convert it to kinetic energy or energy of motion, right? So in ATP has that stored energy. When you break that phosphate bond and you release it, then you're basically releasing that energy to provide energy to for another reaction to proceed. Does that make sense? So you're transferring that stored energy to another chemical reaction to allow it to go. Good? Another thing I'll mention quite a bit is all your batteries as an example of stored energy, right? Good? And once you stick that battery in your remote control, that stored potential energy is being used to run the TV, right? All right. I've covered this already. Oxidation of the reaction reactions, right? Electron donor transfers an electron to an electron acceptor, so then that electron donor becomes oxidized. The electron acceptor is completed. Now, everything is a series of electron transfers. And each of those electron transfers, and what this picture is supposed to be showing is lightning bolt, releases some energy. And you accumulate all that energy to ultimately make ATP. So it's not like you get a little energy and boom, right away make ATP. It's a cumulative effect. Accumulate, and ultimately you'll be able to make ATP.